So these are special trees, and they appear very often and useful. So what is the definition? So a binary tree is a rooted tree where in which every vertex has either one of these, no children, or just a left child, or a right child, or both a left child and a right child. So, for example, it's rooted tree, we put the root at the top, and if it's not a leaf, if it's not a terminal vertex means it has no children. If it's not a terminal vertex, we have three possibilities, including this. There are four possibilities: no child, no children, or just this, or just this. This means, you know, that is a diagram. No children means it's a terminal vertex like that. Left child means it has a child like that on the left. This means right child. And both left child and right child, it looks like this. So if you look at every vertex, it looks like this or this, this or this. Four possibilities. So this is an example. So let me draw a diagram like that. This is a binary tree. So this is the root, and it has two children, left and right. In this vertex has only left child. This vertex has both left and right children. This has only And this, it is important that we distinguish left child and right child. So for instance, this is different from, as binary trees, they are different. Because they look, everything is the same except that this vertex has a left child only, and this vertex has a right child only. Because we distinguish a left child and a right child, they are different. So, for example, binary trees. Let's look at binary trees with n vertices. For small n, let's compute this. So n equals 1, we have only one binary tree, right? N equals 2, how many binary trees do we have? We have a root. Root may have a left child or this. So there are two binary trees like that. What about n equals 3? We have this, right? This is a good one. Or this. Or this. Or this. And this. So there are 5. And you can continue and finding more trees. So these are the binary trees. And it goes like that. Okay. We also consider a special kind of binary tree called a full binary tree. A full binary tree, as the name suggests, is a binary tree. First of all, and every vertex, if it's not a leaf, if it's not a terminal vertex, it has two children. Full binary tree is a binary tree such that every Internal vertex. If it's not a terminal vertex, it means internal vertex, right? Every internal vertex has two children, a left and a right, of course. So, for example, this is not a binary tree, right? Not a full binary tree. Because this vertex has only one child. But, you know, the full binary tree looks like this, right? This is a full binary tree. A full binary tree. Right? It's an easy concept, right? So everything looks like, for a binary tree, we have four possibilities, but for a full binary tree, for every vertex, it looks like either it's a terminal vertex or it's an internal vertex with both the left and right children. So full binary tree like looks like this. So it's simpler in some sense. Okay. And this full binary tree is very common in this the graph of single elimination tournament. Graph of a single elimination tournament. So you have seen this kind of diagram, right? Something like that. The players some players are kind of they don't have to have the same number of levels like this. It's possible. So here is a winner. So each terminal vertex represents a player, right? And then the player one and player two, they play each other, and the winner advances to the next round, and etc. Right? You have seen this kind of thing. So it's a full binary tree. If you think these as vertices and these as edges, then you can see this is a full binary tree, right? Yeah, I already mentioned the terminal vertex and internal vertex, but let me recall you the definition again, because we will use this. A vertex is called a terminal vertex if it has no children. And an internal vertex, is just a non-terminal vertex. So if it's not a terminal vertex, it's an internal vertex. So we will use these two notions, terminal vertex and internal vertex. Okay, for a full binary tree, there is a very simple relation between the number of terminal vertices and the number of internal vertices. So let's state the theorem. T is a full binary tree with, say, I internal vertices. Then T has I plus 1, so one more terminal vertices. So So for a full, it must be a full binary tree. This is important condition. For a full binary tree, number of terminal vertices is always one more than the number of internal vertices. That's what this theorem is saying. And of course, the total number of, what is the total number of vertices then? Of course, just the sum of I and I plus 1 to I plus 1. So in particular, a full binary tree has only odd number of vertices, right? Okay, how can you prove this? Proof. I'm going to give you two proofs. Proof one. So for a tree, many properties of a tree can be proved using induction, because tree has a very simple recursive structure. Because tree is obtained by adding a vertex one at a time, right, at the end. For a full binary tree, we have to add two vertices, right? So let's prove this using induction on n, I. I is the number of internal vertices. So let's say T is a full binary tree. And I is the number of internal vertices. Let's say T is the number of terminal vertices. N is the number of vertices, just for simplicity. But of course, this is T plus I. We want to show that T is I plus 1. That's what we want to show. And we proceed on induction on N. Okay, what if, so yes, here I is at least 0, right? There could be no internal vertices. In that case, what happens? If I equals 0, then what happens? It's just T is just a dot. So terminal so this is a terminal vertex, right? So T equals 1, which is I plus 1. So this is easy. Okay? And assume that, suppose that this induction step, the theorem is true for I is a non-negative integer, and consider a case I plus 1 case. So, you know, now T is a full binary tree with, that means binary tree with I plus 1 vertices, internal vertices. We want to show that there are I plus 2 terminal vertices. Okay? Let's consider just a terminal vertex, one terminal vertex. Consider take a terminal vertex, say V. So T has a tree structure. I don't know, it's complicated, but we have a terminal vertex V. We must have a terminal vertex V. Then it must have a parent, right? Because it's a terminal vertex, and this is not the only vertex, so maybe it can be a left child or a right child, doesn't matter. Let's say it's a left child. It's okay. And we can say we have this situation. So W is a parent, is the parent of U and V, and let's say U is a sibling of V, right? Basically, we took V and if you take U, a V, then you get U and W like that. It looks like this. Complicated. We have this situation. So both, yes. Okay. I think, yeah, in this case, we have to assume that both are terminal vertices. I want to say that both are terminal vertices. So instead of a terminal, instead of taking terminal vertex, let's take an internal vertex. Sorry about that. Instead of taking a terminal vertex, let me change this a little bit. Because, you know, if you take a random terminal vertex, if it's a sibling, parent, this sibling may have children. So that's what we want to know. That's what we want. So find take an internal vertex. Internal vertex that whose children are both terminal vertices. So we want exactly this situation, both U, internal vertex U. So in other words, U and V, these are terminal vertices. Can you take such internal vertices, internal vertex W? Yes, because just take one internal vertex. If this internal vertex must have both children, right? Because it's a full binary tree. If both are terminal vertices, that's okay. Otherwise, one of them is not an terminal vertex, then maybe this is an internal vertex. Then you consider this internal vertex. If both are terminal vertices, this okay. Otherwise, you get to keep going down. You just keep going down, and you have to stop at some point because the tree is finite. So we can always find such an internal vertex. Is it okay? Just find a situation like that because we want to reduce the size of this. And then let T be T prime be T minus these two vertices, U and V. Just remove these vertices. Okay? Then what happens? What happens in T prime? Then what is the number of internal vertices of T prime? It has the same internal vertices except W, because W was an internal vertex in T, but is now a terminal vertex. So except W, everything else is still an internal vertex, so it's I plus 1 minus 1, which is I, right? And by induction, and T prime is also a full binary tree because we just deleted these two terminal vertices. So it's a full binary tree again. So by induction hypothesis, what can you say? By induction hypothesis, T prime has one more terminal vertices than internal vertices. But what are the terminal vertices of T? They are the terminal vertices of T prime, right? But this one was counted as a terminal vertex in T prime. But this is not a terminal vertex. We have to take the minus one. But we have two new terminal vertices in T. So maybe I can continue here. Number of terminal vertices. In T is equal to this one, I plus 1 minus 1 plus 2, because we have minus 1 for W and plus 1 for V and U, right? Which is I plus 2. Again, this is one more than the number of internal vertices of T. Okay? So that's by induction, it's true for I plus 1 and thus for every integer I. That's a proof of this theorem. Question? Any question? So let me give you another proof of this theorem without using induction. Actually, it's simpler. So proof two. If you don't use induction, in this case, it's simpler. So T has I internal vertices. We want to show that the number of terminal vertices is I plus 1. So internal vertex means what? It has two children, right? Every internal vertex has two children because it's a full binary tree. Now let's count just children. What is the number of total number of children without worrying about their parents? What is the total number of children? You know, for every internal vertex, it has two children, right? So for every internal vertex, you know, we have two children. Another internal vertex, we have two, right? And they are all distinct. These are all distinct. You cannot have the same children here counted, right? So for every internal vertex, there are two children, and these are all the children. This means two times I, because there are I internal vertices, and there are, for each internal vertex, it produces two children. So what I counted is like this. Suppose, for example, just three is like this. So internal vertices are like 1, 2, 3, 4, right? What are the children? So it has two children, like 1 and 2, right? This one has 1 and 2, and this one has 1 and 2. This one has 1 and 2, right? So these are the children, right? Without worrying about their parents. And that's exactly two times number of internal vertices. But as you can see from this, what are these? These are every vertex is a children, except it's a root. Except the root, as you can see, except the root, everything is a children, because if it's not a root, it has a parent. So this number of children is number of vertices in T minus 1, because this is a root. Root is not counting. Root is the only vertex that's not a child. So what? This means number of, but what is this? Number of vertices is of course I plus T, if T is the number of terminal vertices. Then of course here, if you have this equation, you get T equals I plus 1. So this is quite simple, right? If you look at, if you focus on the number of children. So we just counted the number of children in two different ways, and that gives us a simple proof of this fact. Okay, this is much simpler than the proof using the induction. Okay, but remember that this is true only for a rooted tree. Full binary tree. If it's not, then of course this is not true. For if T is not full binary tree, it's not true. The theorem is not true. For example, just this is a it's a binary tree, but what is the number of internal vertices? What is the internal vertices? 1, 2, 3. Terminal vertices, there's only one, so this is not true. So this the theorem holds for only full binary tree. The theorem does not hold. All right. Definition? T is a rooted tree with a root, say R. R is the root of the tree. And we, for a rooted tree, we can define the level. The level of a vertex V in T. For every vertex, we define the level. The level is the length of the simple path from R to V. Because it's a tree, for every two vertices, there is a unique simple path. That's a condition for a tree. So we have a, when we have a tree and a root and arbitrary vertex V, you find a unique simple path from U to V, and the length means the number of edges used in the path. The length of the simple path is the level of the vertex. That's the definition. And the height of the tree is the maximum level of in T. Maximum level of a vertex in T. So for example, we have a rooted tree, not necessarily a binary tree. Let's see, we have a tree like that. So this is the root R, of course. So what is the level of the root? The level of the root is zero, because the simple path from R to R is just itself. Here the level is zero. Then these vertices have level what? These vertices have level one, because the simple path is this, and the level is one, the length is one. And what about these? These vertices, they all have level two, because you need two edges from UR to that vertex here. And these vertices here, these vertices have level 1, these vertices have level 2, these vertices have level 3, and these vertices have level 4, these vertices have level 5, and these vertices have level 6, like that. So levels are defined like that. What is the height of this tree? The maximum level, which is 6. So we say that this tree has height 6. Now we have a theorem about binary tree with levels and height. So let's say T is a binary tree with T terminal vertices. And H is the height of the tree, T. Then log of T is less than or equal to H. Or this is log base 2, so equivalently T is less than or equal to 2 to the H. We have this equation, inequality. I'm going to give you two proofs of this theorem. Proof one first, of course. Maybe induction first. Yeah, because trees, yeah, they can be many properties can be proved using induction. So let's use induction on H. So nice thing about induction is that it's kind of routine. It is rather not very interesting, but you don't have to think. You don't have to have. You don't have to come up with a very clever idea. Just a straightforward, in some sense, very routine and straightforward way. So, of course, you have to check the base case. If h equals 0, then what happens? H equals 0, what does that mean? Height is 0. Root has no children, right? So what is t then? We have only t. When t is just a dot, terminal vertices, there's only one, the root. And is this true? T 1 less than or equal to 2 to the 0 is true, because 2 to the 0 is 1. Okay, good. Checked. And the induction step. Suppose that the theorem is true. That the theorem holds for H and consider a binary tree T, say T of height H plus 1. Height h plus 1 and terminal vertices, number of terminal vertices equals t, it's the same. Okay. So we are using induction on the height. That means we want to reduce the height because we want to use the induction hypothesis. If you don't use induction hypothesis, then there is no point of doing induction, right? So you want to reduce the size of H or the height. So if the T looks like this, it has a root, the root R, and because it's a binary tree, we have several situations like this, it has only one child or it has two children, we will consider these two cases. It's like this. So case one, T has only one children, like this. Left or right doesn't matter. T, the root has only one children. One child. It may be left or right, but doesn't really matter. So let's say this is T prime. Let T prime be the tree from obtained from T by removing R. I mean this. If it's, it was here, then it will be the tree over here. So what is the number of what is the height of H prime? Okay, I think I need more space here. What is the height of T prime? The maximum level of T will be the height of T, which is H plus 1, right? We assume this. And what is the height of this then? Just have one less level over here, so this level will be 0, so it will be one less than this. Height is h, okay? Because we deleted this. Now what is the number of terminal vertices? In t prime. In terms of T, they have the same terminal vertices, right? If some vertex is a terminal vertex in T, it is still a terminal vertex in T because all we did was to remove the vertex R. R is not a terminal vertex, so it's T, the same number of terminal vertices. Okay, then I need to move on to the next page. But then it's easy now. By induction hypothesis, number of terminal vertices is less than or equal to 2 to the h, because in T, for T prime, T is the number of terminal vertices, h is the height. But of course, T is less than or equal to 2 to the h is obviously less than or equal to h plus 1. So it's true, right? Because T is the terminal vertex, number of terminal vertices in T, h plus 1 is the height of T. It's true. This is simple. Now case 2, case 1. T has the root. Root R has two children. So T looks like this. R like this. So let's say this is T1 and this is T2. So T minus R is a union of T1 and T2. Both are binary trees, okay? And what are the heights of T1? T1, let's say this is H1, height of T2 equals H2, and terminal number of terminal vertices in T1 equals T1. Let's just name them. Name these numbers. Then what is the height of T1? We don't know exact height of T1, but we can say that this is at most H, right? Because this height is the same way, H plus 1, so this can be at most H, less than or equal to H. Again, this is less than or equal to H. What about this? Terminal vertices in T will be terminal vertices in T1 or T2, so T equals T1 plus T2. Okay? And because of this, because the height of T1 is less than or equal to H, by induction hypothesis, I think we should use a strong induction here, because T, this may be smaller than H. Let's say strong. We are using strong induction. We are assuming that if the height is less than or equal to H, it's true. Number of terminal vertices is less than or equal to 2 to the height. And T2 is less than or equal to H2. Okay? And then, because of this, T is less than or equal to 2 to the H1 plus 2 to the H2, but these are both less than or equal to H, H plus 1. So this is what we want. So the theorem is still true for H plus 1, so by induction, true for every integer H. Okay? This is a proof using induction. Let me give you another proof without using induction. We can just directly prove it. Proof 2. In fact, it's true if the tree is... But before showing you the proof, let me tell you some observation. So we want to show T is less than or equal to 2 to the H. This is what we want, right? We want this. T is a when T is a binary tree. But before showing you the proof, let's just think about this situation. What if T is a full binary tree? If T is a full binary tree, is it any easier? Let's think about this. T is the number of terminal vertices. What is the number of internal vertices then? What is the total number of vertices? If T is the terminal number of terminal vertices. For a full binary tree, we know that the number of terminal vertices is always one more than the number of internal vertices. So T is the number of terminal vertices. Then if I is the number of internal, then we know that T must be I plus 1, or I is T minus 1. And total number of vertices is T plus I, which is, in terms of T, 2T minus 1. Okay? For a full binary tree, this is true. But now, let's look at the typical diagram of a tree, a binary tree. It looks like this. The height is, this is level 0, level 1, level 2, dot, 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 level H. So what is the maximum number of vertices in each level? Here, and here, and here. Here, this only, we have only one vertex there. But what is the maximum possible number of vertices in level 1? 2, right? Because this has 2 vertices, that's 2. What is the maximum possible number of vertices in level 2? If both have 2 children, we have 4 vertices over here, and 8, etc. So this is the maximum number of vertices. In this case, as in this example, number of vertices is always less than or equal to this. This is the maximum, 2 to the h. Okay? So the number of vertices of level I, or maybe I should use different level L, is always less than or equal to 2 to the L. This is an observation. All right? If you think about that diagram, it's quite easy to see. And in this case, for a full binary tree, this is very, very easy, because now number of vertices is 2t minus 1. The height is h, so the maximum number of vertices is 1 plus 2 plus 2 squared plus dot 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 plus 2 to the h, because it has height h. This is the maximum possible number of vertices there. But what is this? Is 2 to the h plus 1 minus 1. Now, if you simplify this, you get t less than or equal to 2 to the h. We get this immediately. But this is for a full binary tree. This is not a proof for our theorem. But this is a good observation. For a general binary tree, what can we do? Because this is not a full binary tree. Now, let me prove the theorem now. But just remember that it's true for full binary tree. Proof 2. If T is a full binary tree, we know it's true. But this is actually not necessary, but yeah. We will prove this anyway. So this is observation. This is just an observation. It's not necessary in the proof. What if T is not a full binary tree? We can add more vertices, more terminal vertices, to make this full binary tree, right? If T, okay, it doesn't matter. Let T prime be the full binary tree. Obtained from T by doing something. if T is a binary, full binary tree already, we can just leave it there. But otherwise, if T is not a full binary tree, some vertex has only one child, right? In this case, just add a new vertex, terminal vertex to that by adding, so one terminal vertex. To every internal vertex with one child, like that. So, for instance, if we had like this, then T prime will be this thing where we added this two, like that. Just add extra terminal vertices. Only to those internal vertices with only one children. We don't add two children, two terminal vertices like that, because this is not an internal vertex, okay? Then what can you say? T prime will be a terminal vertex, I mean, full binary tree, right? Because as you can see, every internal vertex now has two children. Because if it had one, it had one vertex had been already added. T prime full binary tree, and let's say T prime is the number of terminal vertices in T prime. Then what is the number of total number of vertices in T? It is 2T prime minus 1, right? Because it's a full binary tree now. And furthermore, what is the relation between T and T prime? Which one is larger? We only added terminal vertices. So the terminal vertices here are still terminal vertices, right? Terminal vertices are still terminal vertices. And we have more. So this is always greater than or equal to this. And what is the height of T prime? We don't create a vertex of higher height than H, right? Because we don't add this. And height is still the same. Height of T prime is still the same as T, right? And because the number of vertices, the observation that I showed you, of level for a full binary tree, or binary, this is true for every binary tree, not necessarily full binary tree. Level L is less than or equal to 2 to the L for every L. So number of vertices in T prime, which is 2T prime minus 1 less than or equal to 1 plus 2 plus dot 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 2 to the H, which is 2 to the H plus 1 minus 1. From there, we get T is less than or equal to T prime, but this, if you simplify this, this is less than or equal to 2 to the H, as we wished. And that's the proof. Second proof of this. So the idea is try to begin with a simple or special kind of tree, which is easier. And try to change things into the special thing that we have already proved. That's basically the idea here. All right. Now, let's move on to the next section then. 9.6, tree traverse. Traversal. Traversals. So we have a binary tree. We have a binary tree with labeled vertices. Vertices are labeled. So let's write the labels like this. It's binary tree. So left and right are important. F G H I J like that. We have tree, binary tree with vertices labeled A, B, C, D, etc. like that. Now imagine this is really a tree, and suppose that a snail is like this is walking along this, moving along this tree like this. It starts from here and then it moves like this until it reaches A again, like that. And when it moves, when it's moving there, it will visit vertices. And when it visits a vertex, we will record the vertex label. But there are three different ways of doing this. So there are three different ways of, say, read this trace, this tree. And this worm is moving like that. And they are called pre-order. They are called pre-order, in-order, and post-order. So I'm going to explain these one at a time. So for pre-order, basically it means you write the vertex label when you first visit that vertex. Maybe I need more space, but write at the first visit. What does that mean? Because we visit one vertex more than once. Sometimes, you know, you visit, in this case, you visit B and C, and then you visit B back again, like that. So, pre-order is quite simple. Just read it as soon as you visit that vertex. So, pre-order, what is the pre-order reading of this tree? We start with A, so we read A first. A, and then B, right? Here we are B, at B, and C, like that. And we are back to B again, but we don't read twice, just once, it's done. And now here, D, and then E, and then D, B, A, and F, and G, H, I, and then H, J, and everything has been already read. So this is the pre-order reading of this tree. Okay. And post-order, let me explain post-order and then in-order later. This is the opposite, right at the last visit. A, you leave A, but we know that we will return to A again, so we don't read A yet, just yet, because this is not the last time we visit A. You just continue. B, again, this is not the last time we visit B, because we will be visited again, so we continue. C. But now, when we leave C, we don't come back to C anymore, so we read C here, at this point. So C. And then B, we know that we will visit this again, so we don't read this. It's not the last time. D, again, this is not the last time for D. E, now this is the last time for E, so E. And D, this is the last visit for D, so we write D. And again, here b, we will this b for the last time, so we write b. A, this is not the last time, so we continue. F, not last time, not last time, not one. And here I is the last time, we need to leave there. H, we can come back. J is the last time, so write J. H, this is now the last time for H. And G, last time. F is the last digit. And A, finally. This is the reading obtained by post order. Okay? These are quite, easy to understand. In order, similar but slightly more confusing, I think. In order is something in between, right? So, to explain in order ordering, let me tell you this. So we have a label, say X, over here. It has left and right children, right? Maybe they're missing, but suppose that they have. So we have something like that. I don't know, we have a situation. So we will visit, we go like that. All right? For in order, we read the vertex X when we finish the left subtree. So let's say the subtree rooted at the, say, a left child. Meaning at this point, whenever we visit over here, whenever we finish, as soon as we finish it, everything on the left of on the tree rooted at the left child of X, we read X. So for in order we read, so as a diagram, in order we read at this point, say in order, and for pre-order, right? So in other words, pre-order we read at this point as soon as we visited X. Post-order we we are going like that. For in order, it is somewhere in the between, in the middle of X. This is in order. That's when we read X. That's the idea, okay? So let's try to read the tree using in order. So in order reading is like this. Here, do we read A? No, because we haven't finished the tree over here. So we just continue. What about C here? We read C because we finish it, everything that's tree rooted at here. But that's nothing, so we just there. C, okay? But now here, when we are here, we finish it everything to the left of B, so we read B. In the middle of B, we read. Again, here, we are in the middle of D, because the left of D has nothing. So we read D, and E we read. And here, we finish it everything on the left of A, so we read A now. And E, F, we are passing through the center of, you know, if center of F now, so F. G, not yet. H, not yet. But now I. And when you are here, we are passing through the center of B, below, so H. And J, and G, and we are done. This is the in order reading. Is it clear or any question? Can you distinguish these two, these three? Okay. So why are we doing this? These are useful to record binary operations. So let's express this binary expression A plus B times C minus D over E. So these can be represented using this binary tree. Here the operations are internal at the internal vertices, and the terminal vertices represent the numbers or indeterminates. So this tree means we do this operation with these two numbers, A and B. And if you do this, you get a new number, right? And then you do this operation with the result here and this. And that will give you another number here. And this, we do this and this with this operation, that will give you a number over here. And then finally, we do this operation with these two numbers. That's basically what this is. But this is obtained by reading this tree using in order, right? Try to read this in order, right? Here we visit A first. I mean, we pass through the center of A below. So A and what? Plus and B and star, or multiplication, and C, and minus, and D, and division, and E, right? You can see they are in the same order. This is called in fixed form of an expression. And this is a common expression, and we really use this kind of expression, right? We are familiar with this. So if we read this in order, we obtain this. Let's try to use a different pre-order and post-order. What is the pre-order? Minus, right? Minus star and plus and A and B and C and D. Division and D and E. This is a prefix form of an expression. What about postfix? We record when we visit for the last time. So not A and B and plus and C and star and what? D and E, divide, and this. Is that right? These are it's a prefix and postfix. We are more familiar with this because we are using this. But for in fixed form, we need parentheses, because otherwise there is an ambiguity here. It's not clear which one we have to do first. Because here, in this tree, we really meant this. We add this first, right? So here, for in fixed form, we need parentheses. Without parentheses, we cannot express without ambiguity. These look very strange if this is your first time to see this, but they are nice in the sense that we don't need parentheses. This expression itself is enough to reconstruct the tree. Both of these. So in computer, I think these are used to record the expression in computer, because it's more compact. We don't need extra parentheses, etc. By the way, can you really reconstruct this back from this? Let's try to do that. The prefix form is like, I'm just copying the same thing. Suppose that only these are given. No, they're the same thing, like here. These are only given, and how can we reconstruct the tree? All we need, if you can change this into this binary form, I mean infix form with parentheses, that's fine, right? It is enough to construct this, because we know from here to there is easy. So all we need to do is to which operation is applied to which letters. The thing is, for a prefix, you just read from backward. These two must be applied to this. So this will be D minus E. So this should apply to this. So now this is just one number, right? And just read that backward. This operation, from backward, find the first operation. This is already have been taken. And this will apply to both these, the previous ones. This should apply to this. Now this is one single number. So this must be applied to the two adjacent one, to the next to it. So this is like that. And finally, this must be applied to this. This is it. So maybe we can write this way. So D minus E, divided by E for this. And this A minus A plus C, B. And this, we multiply this and this and this, so multiply by this. And finally, we take minus sign there. This is it. This is exactly this thing. And then from there, we can reconstruct. Similarly, for post order, we can do the same thing. Only start from the right, left. So, but example for infix, suppose we have two expressions like this one. Let's represent the trees for this expression. So we have star plus 1 and 2 and 3. And here we have plus 1, multiplication, 2, 3. They are different expressions, right? They are different. And let's use infix, in order. Let's read this using in order. So it'll be 1 plus 2, right? Multiplication, and 3. Okay? What about this? 1 plus 2, multiplication, and 3. You can see they are the same for in order. They are represented by the same things, but they are different. So you cannot distinguish these two if you use in order only without using parentheses. But if you use pre-order, so what is the first one in pre-order? Let's use a red one. Pre-order, then star plus 1, 2, and 3, right? What about the second one? Here is plus 1, star, 2, and 3. You can see they are different. And similarly, for post order, we read 1, and then 2, and then plus, and 3 and star, and here 1 2 star, oh no, not star, 1 2 3 star plus, they are different. So both pre-orders and post-orders, they distinguish everything nicely, but for in-order you cannot distinguish these two without using parentheses. So in this sense, post-order or pre-order, they are nicer than in-order reading.